Good evening in Moscow. My name is Joe Crescente. For those of you who don't know me, I am the Media Literacy Fellow for the American Center in Moscow. And welcome to our first ever event in our speaker series. Tonight we have a special treat planned for you. But before we begin, just some minor housekeeping. This speaker series will continue throughout the winter and into the spring and summer. So do look out in upcoming weeks for other additional speakers, American speakers, on topics related to media and digital literacy. I just will make a plug very quickly for a couple of things that I do. So every Wednesday, I have a media literacy discussion club at 6 p.m. Moscow time, which I encourage anyone who's interested in topics related to digital literacy to join. You can, you know, learn about certainly new and interesting topics, connect with other people, and of course, practice your English. And I would encourage you also, if you are interested, we do have, I recently launched a Telegram channel called Learn Digital. Hopefully it is appearing, the link to join is appearing in the YouTube chat, where I will give 1 to 2 tips per week just on practical everyday things you can do to not feel so overwhelmed by the digital landscape in which we live in. Let's get to the main event. I'm going to introduce our speaker. It is my great privilege to welcome Natasha Lance Rogoff, who is an award-winning filmmaker, journalist, television producer, and author of Muppets in Moscow, The Unexpected Crazy True Story of Making Sesame Street in Russia, which I read last year. It's a great book, very interesting, very much captures that moment in the 1990s in Russia and what challenges there were to create a major television international co-production. Natasha has also written extensively about Russian underground culture and led the production of Sesame Street in Russia and Mexico. She's an associate in the Art, Film, and Visual Studies Department at Harvard University and is passionate about media that creates bridges for cross-culture understanding. Muppets in Moscow, the book, was nominated for the prestigious Pushkin Book Prize in 2023 and won first prize for Best First Book and Best Audiobook from the Independent Publishers Association and the Independent Book Awards. And with that, I will give over the floor to Natasha. Welcome.
Joe, it's a great honor to be here speaking with everybody who's come in to take part in the American Center in Moscow. The last time I was in Moscow was January of 2020 to interview my former colleagues for the book, and I miss being there. So it's wonderful to connect with all of you today, and I look forward to hearing your questions after I speak a little bit about my experience connected with creating Ulitsa Sezam, which means Sesame Street in Russian. And I apologize for not speaking Russian. It has been a long time since I was regularly speaking and just did not want to subject you to my mistakes. Today, I'm going to speak about the creation of the show, which was incredibly popular. The show aired for more than 10 years. It aired on Russia's two top television stations, ORT and NTV, and it aired across 11 time zones of the former Soviet Union, and also was aired in Russia, Ukraine, Armenia, Georgia. So over the years, you know, this is more than 30 years ago, I've met so many adults who grew up on Ulitsa Sezam and fell in love with the Muppets that were created. So the program started in the 1990s. This was just after the collapse of the Soviet Union. And for those of you who are not familiar with Sesame Street, the American show. It originated in 1969, and it is still on the air today, reaching its 55th year in production and being broadcast. So it's very similar to Spokojne noći malaši, but of course, you know, in terms of its longevity, but not in terms of its style. The goal of the show was to create an entertaining program that would also promote social justice and education for all children, but especially for children living in disadvantaged communities. So the program is based on quite a bit of research, educational research and science, which made it really different from programs like Disney or Nickelodeon streamed programs. But the first international co-productions where the content is created in collaboration with the local country where the program is being produced started in the 1970s. And as Joe mentioned, I produced the show in Mexico, which is called Plaza Sesamo. That was the first show that I had worked on. And then the next show was in Moscow. And the brilliance of the show was chiefly the Muppets and the music. That's sort of my opinion. It was an incredible reinterpretation of what a puppet looked like by the genius puppet master, Jim Henson. And he sadly passed away. But this is what he looks like. And this is slide three. Yes, thank you. And the world fell in love with his googly-eyed Muppets, as well as their really positive, hilarious, and open perspective on the world. And the idea to create an original Sesame Street show in Russia, in Russian, was introduced by a young senator called Joe Biden, who's now the US president. So he was keen to work with Sesame Workshop, which was the company producing Sesame Street, with Jim Henson and many other talented artists living in New York City and around the country. And the U.S. Congress worked closely with the Russian Ministry of Education and Russian teachers in order to develop, you know, this new program, which would involve 60% original production in Moscow and regions across the former USSR, including the former republics. So the idea was that new Slavic-style Muppets would be created, an entirely new neighborhood, a studio set, and the content for the show would be created by hundreds of artists in Moscow. These are Russians, Ukrainians, Armenians, Georgians. And so I was tagged to lead this team with Volodya Gramatikov, who is a very famous children's director of movies, a wonderful man. And together we became a family. And for the next, for me, it was 5 years. For the team, it was about 3 years, 2 to 3 years. And we created a show that became a hit. So just a bit about myself. I first moved to Russia when I was 22 years old, and I was part of a U.S.-Soviet exchange program in 1982, where I was learning Russian and studying at Leningrad State University, now St. Petersburg State, I assume. And I ended up developing really deep friendships with many of the artists that I was writing about and making films about. And a number of those musicians ended up creating music, composing music for the Russian version of Sesame Street 10 years later. So there's real continuity in my life. And the writing of this story, for the book Muppets in Moscow, is a really personal story for me, because of how much time I have spent in your country and my deep affection for working with the many absolutely brilliant genius artists that I worked with there. I'd like to say that the process of making the show was very challenging, 1990s. So really from 1993. And this was a period of incredible instability as the country was transitioning from a command economy and communism to something that was going to be different, a more open society. There were, you know, the medical system was in a state of disrepair. There was enormous poverty, food shortages. And it was into this environment that our team was trying to operate in a constantly changing television industry as well. Advertising had just been introduced into Russia. And there was also something that I hadn't expected in this era was violence. So the first months when we were trying to create the show, we encountered a particular oligarch who was helping us with possibly sponsoring the show. And his car was blown up. He was severely burned. And that was our first encounter with trying to find somebody who could provide financing for the production. So the U.S. Congress put in half of the funding, but all the funding had to be matched by money coming from Russia through either the state television or from private sponsors. So that was very, very upsetting. And I had been in the car that had been blown up 3 weeks earlier. So was kind of rattled from that. And then a year later, we were working with Vlad Listyev, who many of you, I imagine, have heard of. But he was a really great man trying to bring press freedom to Russia. And he was the host of many different television programs, which were widely watched across the former USSR and across post-communist Russia. His show, he ran a Jeopardy-like show, which is like a game show. He was the host of that. And then also a program, which was like a talk show, Час пик. For me personally, he was very helpful to me and my colleagues in advising us how to navigate the Russia's TV industry at that time. And he was a huge fan of what we were trying to do for children in Russia. And he came to a very sad ending because he was assassinated as he was leaving the TV station one evening. And the man who then led the station after him was also killed. So this was the beginning of trying to make this children's puppet show in Russia, in Moscow. And it required an incredible level of patience and understanding because of the instability and violence that was occurring at that time. But the team I was working with was incredibly passionate and dedicated. And they imagined that this TV show for children could, could really change things, not only, you know, on the little screen, but they hoped in the future in reality. And there were many, many ways that making this show required that we all compromise and figure out ways to work together because we came from very different cultures. So, one of the places where we had a lot of debates and discussions were around the design of the Muppets themselves And I found this particularly fascinating because when I first showed my my teammates the American Muppets and some of the Muppets from the other international co-productions, they really didn't like them. And the head writer said to me, we want to use our own traditional puppets. We, you know, have a puppetry tradition dating back to the 16th century. And we don't really see why we need to change the puppets and how what they look like, you know, for this new show. Why can't we use our puppets in our new Sesame Street show in Ulitsa Sezam? So this was complicated because, of course, Sesame Street was a brand. And also the puppets, the Muppets, were really a part of that show. And the process of creating the Muppets was also intrinsic to working with countries to develop a new way of envisioning aesthetics. But the show was also supposed to reflect the values, culture, and aesthetics of Russia and the other new countries that were going to be watching this show. So when I was talking with my team, they said that they wanted to create their own puppets based on Russian folklore. And the character that they wanted to base their puppet on was Domovoy, who is a spirit of the hearth in the home. I'm sure many of you are familiar with his images from Russian literature. But when the team drew their design for a Muppet version of Domovoy, he was drawn as an old man, sort of a hunchback, beady-eyed character. And when I showed the drawings to the Jim Henson team, these are the really talented puppet designers and creators, they came back to me and said, you know, we really think the character, the Muppet character for this show should be more childlike and playful so that young children can identify with the character. And that the whole idea is that, you know, the child experiences all kinds of challenges and in the show, and that they figure out how to overcome those challenges, much like the Muppet would, you know, and they learn in the process. So to continue with that, I would also like to add that one of the other issues where we were at odds with each other had to do with the music. And initially, the extremely talented music director, who was a celebrated concert pianist and composer, wanted the music in Ulitsa Sezam to be only classical. And of course, this made sense because many, almost all, animated children's cartoons at that time used classical music. And the traditions, Russia was also very proud. The people I was working with were very proud of their music and wanted to include that in the show. So these were many discussions because we were also trying to give new opportunities to musicians, many of whom had been persecuted under communism, that were, you know, musicians who were making contemporary music. And we had hoped that the show would feature innovative, diverse, new sounds so that the program could reflect what was going to be new Russia and would also include a wide swath of the music culture in post-communist Russia. So for months, the drama about the Muppets and the design for the new show continued. And eventually, the team came up with their own interpretation of Domovoy. And this is what he looks like. So this is slide 7. So you can see on the right, and this was an absolutely ingenious design. He has, his name is Zeliboba, and many of his, he's for instance, he's wearing sneakers, which are, you know, were very popular at the time. You know, lots of kids were wearing sneakers, and the chief supervising producer came up with that idea, which was, you know, absolutely brilliant. And the to reflect the characters being at one with nature in the spirit of Domovoy, the design had his coat. He has leaves and moss and fur sewn into his fur and organza. And he lives inside a giant oak tree on the set. So this was an absolutely magical, nurturing, playful character who emerged from the idea of Domovoy and Russian folklore. And the other two Muppets, Kubik and Businka, were also absolutely brilliant and broke many stereotypes, particularly for women at the time. So once the Muppets were established, we then moved on to development of educational goals for the production. And I was, you know, this was one of my favorite parts of being involved in the production, because it was so fascinating to see what my colleagues wanted the show to teach the next generation of children. And we held a curriculum seminar, which is a standard methodology for international co-productions for Sesame Street all over the world, which bring together the creative team and children's education experts, both in health, math, you know, all the subjects that children are learning at a young age. And some of the ideas that the group came up with after 3 days, I thought I would read some of them, but that the child will understand their future is not determined by anything other than their initiative, ideas, and actions without being inhibited by a closed society. They wanted stories to show cooperation and tolerance for all people, including those from diverse ethnic groups. They wanted children to grow up being proud of their country and appreciate that they come from a great nation that has contributed to world knowledge and culture. They wanted children to be raised happy, healthy, and curious people who are confident and believe they have a positive future. And they wanted children to learn how to support each other and understand why it is important to get along. I wanted to show a segment which is an example of one of the goals, which was teamwork, working together and helping each other to achieve what each person dreams of. So this is slide 14. So So that was actually the show opening, which I was going to show next, but it's fine. We'll come back to the other video. But the show opening, as you can see, the animation is somewhat dated now because of advances in technology. But at the time, that was the first mixed medium animation, live action and animation that had been done in Russia at the time. Would it be possible to show, I think it now would be slide 13, which is the segment that shows team building and helping each other realize your dreams. Hello? Oh, well. Hello? Yeah. Lost him? Maybe.
I don't think so. I think he said it's loading. I can see. Okay. Just take a second. So.
Okay, great. Thank you. It's hard not to see you all. So I'm not sure sometimes what's happening out there. We can show that in a second. Is he ready or not sure?
I assume they'll just jump in whenever it's ready. But
okay.
In the meantime, I mean, so this segment is about team building.
Yeah.
And, was that a concept that was, easy to kind of develop with the team at the time? I mean, essentially, that's what you were doing. And that's what the book is more or less about.
Yeah, it's about, I think what's most fascinating in writing the book was realizing how change happens and how much time it took, you know, that it was a process. And, we come from very different cultures. So there had to be an understanding of what made sense for their own country, because the show had to be popular, had to be accepted. And it was eventually, because it very much reflected the traditions and aesthetics of their country, of Russia. But I think that it was really important for all of us to take the time to listen to each other and realize where we could find places of compromise. So that is very much what the book shows. And of course, it's a really interesting way to look at these questions, but through Muppets and a children's, TV show. Also, I found that even though I had lived in Moscow and St. Petersburg for many years, the process of working on Ulitsa Sezam gave me a much deeper understanding of the culture and my colleagues than formerly, as a journalist, because we were all working to improve the lives of children. And in that case, people are so genuine, and it's very intimate when you're talking about the hopes and dreams of people's children. So it was a very different feeling of being all part of one family, trying to deal with all sorts of obstacles in this very difficult period to create something that was beautiful and would go on to impact the lives of tens of millions of children and their families.
Okay, as far as I know, it looks like it is ready to be shown.
Great.
Я сейчас мечтаю, чтобы поскорее нашелся мой любимый галстук, а то я его вчера потерял.
Кать, а ты о чем?
О том, чтобы поскорее вернулись папа и мама. Я по ним так скучаю.
А я вот мечтаю о том, чтобы научиться самой летать. Но это никогда не сбудется. Ай, никогда.
Бусь, а ты не грусти. Хочешь, я подарю тебе свой шарик. Вот. И тебе станет веселее. На.
Да, Бусь, ты мой шарик тоже возьми.
Бери, бери.
Может быть, ты все-таки когда-нибудь научишься.
Угу.
Ага, спасибо. Ой, 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 я уже, кажется, научилась.
Ой.
И да.
Ой, Катя, смотри, Буся летит.
Ой.
Ух ты. Полетела. Буся, а что ты видишь там наверху?
Синепапа, я вижу твой галстук. Вон он под деревом лежит. Кать, а вот твои папа и мама. Они возвращаются домой.
Я же говорил, мечты сбываются.
Да, но у меня появилась новая мечта.
Какая?
So, as you can see, the show is really sweet. And it was also, the pacing was very different from the US show. It was much slower. And the discussions with the script writers, which I write about extensively in the book as well, also revealed a great deal because many of the writers felt that they didn't want the program to be what they called cloyingly sentimental, as they often referred to as the American show. But they wanted their show to reflect the reality that existed in their own country. So there were very different ideas of what was funny too. So I write about that as well. But this show impacted the lives of so many people. And, you know, as I'm traveling, talking about this book here and in Europe, I'm meeting people everywhere who tell me what their favorite episode is, who's their favorite Muppet in Ulitsa Sezam. And it's incredibly heartwarming to see this. A little bittersweet, but I... you know, am so proud of our team and what we did together. And it is a testament for what we can do and what art can do, you know, to build mutual understanding, tolerance, peace, and prosperity, you know, for our little world. So maybe this is a good point to bring in Joe and for us to see if there are any questions from our audience.
Yeah, there's already one. It's pretty similar to one I was going to ask you. This is the question. I'll read it verbatim.
Mm-hmm.
What was the most challenging task in bringing Sesame Street to post-Soviet country? Any cultural differences? Looks like a challenging task since Sesame Street doesn't involve any classical Russian themes. Like difficult ones, you know, it's like a very light and lively, you know, kind of.
Well, the show is for preschoolers, you know, it's for young children. So it's not going to directly in any didactic way address what you think of as heavier themes. But, you know, the themes that the writers decided to address were actually quite what I would think of as profound issues. So, for instance, one aspect of the show, the writers and the education experts wanted to model for young children what is a civil society. And part of that entailed a very long discussion about how to portray characters being polite and respectful to each other, because this was coming out of communism and language had been so heavily affected. For instance, when people went to you know, to buy bread or whatever, and they were calling each other, you know, Zhenshina, Mushina, and they wanted to change that so that there was more, I would say, kindness, you know, in places where people were interacting in public. And There was also an understanding that what had been typically isolated to the private sphere in terms of what people were talking about could now shift into the public sphere. You know, people's willingness to talk about feelings. Another example of this is building the set. So when we had to create a totally new neighborhood, which was going to reflect, you know, new Russia, the set designer, who was a brilliant set designer coming from theater, Masha Rabasova was so talented. And she came to me and said, you know, I'm not sure what the set should look like. Should it look like pre-revolutionary Russia, our recent Soviet past, or something new that we don't even know what it looks like yet? And she was having a little trouble coming up with a design. And ultimately, as you saw in the video, the set combined architectural elements from all of Russia's past history, as well as buildings from both urban and rural environments. Those decisions were, you know, that came, that's the set design in the back. You see the scrim in the back, the backdrop, which included Khrushchevian, you know, buildings, Stalin buildings, Orthodox, Russian Orthodox churches, dachas. It was all reflected in the backdrop and then in the construction of the buildings on the set as well. And it was very important for the team, the creative team, to have elements of nature in the set because they felt, you know, the Rodina was part of Russia and really important to show that. But all of these little details were so carefully designed, you know, even down to the color that the Muppets would be, where the team consulted the Kandinsky's, Vasily Kandinsky, the very famous painter, his book of color, theory of color, and what emotions are attached to various colors so that the children would have a peaceful feeling from the Muppets themselves. I mean, it was a very, I would say, sophisticated production. One of, well, for me personally, the most sophisticated production I ever participated in my life because of who my partners were in this. And so, you know, there were, these are some of the discussions that went on and reflect differences in our cultures in addressing how my team wanted their program to look, feel, and educate and entertain children.
And how did this differ? You know, you do have experience on in other Sesame Streets, so to speak, in other places. How did that differ, that process or that the intensity or the sophistication compared to your other experiences?
No, it's a great question. I mean, there was a time of great trauma. People felt enormous pain. And in some cases, there was a sense of humiliation at the implosion of a superpower. You know, you had all these different countries separating off from the Union and becoming independent countries like Ukraine, Georgia, Armenia. And so it was a period of enormous transition. It was a great historical moment for people. And it's difficult for human beings to grasp that level of change and turmoil in their lives, along with the socioeconomic difficulties. So, you know, the show itself, every single aspect of the show, like the script writing, the educational goals, the set design, everything was affected by the environment in which we were operating in. And my team felt an incredible responsibility to create a show that was going to do good, that was going to be positive and contribute in a way that it would help model idealistic values of tolerance and compassion for children, as well as provide new skills that children would need. You know, they were coming from a more a learning environment that was more didactic. And what the kinds of skills that children needed were, you know, how to take the initiative, believe in themselves, express their individuality and their freedom of expression. So the show, my team was very focused on writing scenarios that would capture that and provide this next generation with the tools that they would need to thrive in this new, very different open society.
What about, have you gotten any feedback? What kind of feedback have you gotten from people over the years? You know, the kind of impact that the show had on them?
Well, I can tell you, you know, I mean, there was a lot of research studies that were done on the show, and they had ratings on the show, and it was hugely successful, you know, for more than 10 years. But I, you know, anecdotally, I meet people all the time. And, you know, recently I had one woman who I met in London who was talking to me about growing up on the show, and she was crying and saying, you know, thank you so much for doing this. You know, I grew up on this. This was my childhood. It was a really sweet vision of the country. So, you know, there's a lot of, you know, anecdotal and, as I say, research-based information about how successful the show was. But this show was very much, as you can see, it is a Russian show. It is also includes elements of the team wanted to focus on bringing out and respecting different nationalities. So they had they had segments which focused on Ukrainian, Armenian, Georgian culture in order to represent what was the former Soviet Union, because the show was produced only 3 years after the Soviet Union collapsed.
One question I'm just really curious about, it's one of the ones that I sent you, but you know, it sounded like a pretty overwhelming project in the beginning. As you mentioned, some of the tragedies that befell the production in the beginning, and reading about it, you know, there are chapters and chapters about, we're almost there. Nope, back to the beginning. Almost there, back to the beginning. And you were quite young and you had some experience, but in many ways, this was probably, you know, a big responsibility for you, for sure. However, you succeeded through this, I think. You know, you seem to have, quote unquote, you know, faked it until you made it. And that confidence that you gained there really seems to help you have launched your career. So I guess my question is, what advice do you have for young professionals who are given a big opportunity that they might feel a little unprepared for?
I would say fake it till you make it is very accurate. And especially since I had absolutely very limited children's television experience, you know, only the experience in Mexico. And before that, I was, you know, a documentary film producer. So had made just, you know, serious films for adults. But, you know, first of all, it was so important to understand that it wasn't just me doing this. I had an incredible team. And without them, it wouldn't have happened. We would have failed. They had, you know, the team had to make so many sacrifices, personal sacrifices. There were times when our bank accounts were frozen and people were not getting paid for months at a time. That was pretty standard at the time, including the military sometimes wasn't getting paid for 3 months. So it was a very difficult production. But also, I think, understanding that that you don't know everything, and you know, you have to be open to and very flexible to seeing how your team wants to create the program, and then, you know, figuring out how to help them create the show that they want to create. I think those are really important factors in succeeding, especially in another country.
Well, a number of people have questions about broadly based about, you know, any current work you have going on and or maybe future projects. And I guess that also can include dream projects as well, if you want to say anything about that.
I have, I mean, I would love to be able to go back to Russia and film again, but that's not possible right now. And so, I think I'm enjoying being able to talk about the incredibly talented and amazing group of artists that I worked with in Moscow. I'm in touch with many of them still today. A number of them are really close friends who I've now known for more than 30 years. And so as far as, you know, what I'm doing next, I'm hoping to develop this story as a property for television or for documentary or otherwise. And we'll see how that happens. I mean, we're just coming out of the strike in Los Angeles. And so it's unclear, you know, how things are going to be. But that's where my focus is now. And of course, trying to do as much as I can to support the artists around the world who I worked with.
And anything you can say about, I mean, is there any, there must be certain aspects of, you know, intercultural communication that you acquired, you know, doing this project in Russia as well as doing it in Mexico that you probably use in your day-to-day life or would encourage others to use. Can you comment on that?
People ask me about that all the time. And of course, many international businesses are, you know, global. They're operating in many countries. And so some people have approached me and said, well, what is it? What worked, you know, in, a lot of times they're interested in marketing. Well, I don't work for any of these companies because that's really not where my focus is. And, you know, like Coca-Cola, I wouldn't want to be selling sugary sweetened drinks, you know, in a country I love in Russia. I will say what I did learn from doing this is that, you know, we as Americans cannot expect countries to mirror our own. And that the historical trajectories for these different countries are different. So they are going to create different kinds of children's television programs, as well as have different policies. But I think the values that Ulitsa Sezam represented in terms of respect for all nations and you know, sovereignty as well is, you know, our values that my colleagues at the time shared and included in the TV show.
The first half of the book is basically about really the challenges of getting it off the ground. What was the moment when you weren't even sure it sounded like if it was really going to work out for quite a while. Because like I said, you know, you kept getting close and then there'd be some huge obstacle would appear. What was the moment where you really understood, okay, this is going to happen. This is going to work out. Everything's going to be fine. And what were the emotions like at that day?
Yeah, honestly, there was never a moment. We all thought that we would fail constantly. I mean, every week something would happen. I mean, even in the beginning, like as we were starting to make the production, you know, the filming part was going on. Then our offices got taken over by soldiers with AK-47s. and they took all the equipment, all of our scripts, the set designs, everything was sealed in that office with a lock and a seal that the soldiers put on it. And we had to start again from scratch. I mean, this was an insane production. And when that happened, you know, I thought if I were, you know, my teammates, I would be like, okay, this is enough. I'm done now. But every single person on our team, you know, just said, okay, when do we start again tomorrow? And they worked out of their homes. There were no cell phones then, you know, you had satellite phones, but they were very expensive and none of us had them. And so, you know, it was very hard to find everybody and connect and talk. And we figured out a way, but nobody quit after that. The team was so dedicated to what we were doing. And it was a tremendous opportunity because there really wasn't much programming for young children at the time. There wasn't money in the state budget for television production or for film. So what we were able to do is the team that came together were really the top people from the film industry, from theater, and you know the TV industry was not very developed at that time because it had been used mostly for propaganda before that, and so it was very different from where we were in the States. And also having many years of creating advertising. So some of the challenges had to do with, like for instance, Azvuchenya, the sync sound, and shooting with three cameras with sync sound at the same time, not editing in the sound afterwards. This was new for people shooting in television. And we had a lot of technical learning that had to happen, as well as all these other crazy things going on.
Somebody from the audience wants to know, what has your experience been like? Have you rewatched some of these episodes long after they aired? What is that experience like for you?
Oh my God, I'm still so proud of what we did, and they make me laugh. And I think they're so sweet, and the writing is fantastic. The music was really, I think, you know, eight class, just absolutely top class, and it also carries over the years. I mean, some of the animation, as I say, because the advances in animation were so extreme. But the live action footage, it's still just so wonderful. I mean, it's, as I say, it represents this period of time in Russia when the country was coming together and trying to figure out what they wanted to be next. And I think in some ways it was a difficult time because it was the start of a new era in Russia. And, you know, we were building something that was new and no one really knew what it was going to be. And then we created it, you know, together. And when you look at it, it represents a totally new vision of Russia, which was very sweet and peaceful and collaborative, as well as highly entertaining and educational.
Okay, well, we're running out of time. Do you have anything else you would like to impart with the audience before we end?
Well, I want to thank everybody for joining today and taking the time to, you know, go back in time with me to talk about this period. And I can only say that I hope a time comes again when we can work together and make another version of Ulitsa Sezam And I look forward to coming back to Russia again when it's possible. So thank you. And thank you to the American Center for inviting me.
Great. I want to thank Natasha so much for this really great talk. I think the audience enjoyed it a lot. I certainly did. And for those who have joined us, please check out the programming at the American Center. There's virtual events happening almost every day, which you can, you know, connect with other people, learn about new and interesting topics, practice your English, learn about things. So thank you for joining us. And please look out in the American Center's website and TimePad calendars for future events. And I will say, have a great evening. Thank you, Natasha.
Thank you so much.